This exploration was made possible by Skillshare, an online learning community with over 25,000 classes. You can see he was being removed from pictures and videos with Kim Jong-un. You'll spot him there on the left, but not on the right. There he is again, but there he's not. Credit to the German newspaper Der Spiegel, which combed through screenshots from North Korean state TV to see the differences. Clearly, the North Korean regime was trying to erase the existence of someone who had often appeared with the dear leader, to purge him from the record. But who, and why? Often the case with opaque North Korea is that we simply don't know anything. But not in this example. In this example, I can at least tell you the who. The man was Jang Song-taek, a high-ranking official in the North Korean government under both Kim Jong-un and Kim Jong-il before him. Here he is on December 20th, 2011 at the laying-in state of Kim Jong-il, and here he is walking behind Kim Jong-un at the funeral a week later. Jang Song-taek was close to the Kims not because of his status in the government and military, but because he was family. He was Kim Jong-il's brother-in-law, and therefore Kim Jong-un's uncle. In fact, he was so high-ranking that in the final years of Kim Jong-il's failing health, North Korea observers believe Jang Song-taek was running the government while helping to groom Kim Jong-un to take over after his father's death. Some even said he was a reformer, perhaps signaling new ways for North Korea under new leadership. And so everything seemed to be going to plan after Kim Jong-il died in 2011. Kim Jong-un, the son, with his uncle Jang Song-taek, walking alongside a 1976 Lincoln hearse and wailing crowds. But questions remained. Most glaring, how would the transfer of power from Kim Jong-il to Kim Jong-un play out? The world knew so little about the dictator's son. At the time of his father's death, we knew that Kim Jong-un had spent time in a school in Switzerland as a child, and that he was thought to be in his late 20s? And that's it. Did he intend to follow in his father's footsteps by keeping North Korea under an iron thumb and developing nuclear weapons? Or might he handle domestic and international affairs differently? What would Kim Jong-un do? Not long after his ascension, we learned the domestic part of that answer. Within 2 years, December 2013, he had his uncle Jang Song-taek arrested at a party conference, accused of a vague plot to form a faction. See if you can parse the explanation by state media. Here it is.
Jang Song-taek, violating the principle of the cabinet center system, did tremendous harm to the economic work of the country and the improvement of the people's living, and, steeped in capitalist way of life, led a dissipated and degenerative life.
Whatever his supposed crime, he was arrested, executed by anti-aircraft machine guns, then burned on the spot. The record of his existence was then removed from pictures and videos. So very quickly, we learn that domestically, Kim Jong-un would continue the ruthlessness of his father. Which leaves only the second half of our question. What would he do on the international stage?
Hello and welcome to BBC News. A fast-moving wave of huge cyber attacks has swept the globe, affecting computers in thousands of locations.
NHS Blackpool Clinical Commission Group says all patients should avoid contacting GPs or using hospital services unless absolutely necessary.
50% of phones at Whips Cross are down. Pathology labs also severely affected, so we can't get patient blood test results.
We ask patients to only come to our A&Es if absolutely necessary. We do not yet know how long this incident will last, and therefore are cancelling all outpatient, endoscopy, cardiology and radiology appointments.
Kettle's still working, so we'll be okay.
Around lunchtime on May 12, 2017, computers in some of the largest hospitals in London began to lock up one by one. Data about patients, appointments, scans, inaccessible. But these computers weren't crashing. Instead, doctors or nurses who tried to use a PC were met with this message. Oops, your files have been encrypted. Many of your documents, photos, videos, databases, and other files are no longer accessible because they have been encrypted. Maybe you are busy looking for a way to recover your files, but do not waste your time. Nobody can recover your files without our decryption service. Send $300 worth of Bitcoin to this address. As if that wasn't chilling enough for a hospital, a timer on the left counted down exactly 3 days, after which the price would double, and another timer with 1 week, after which all files would vanish forever. As news services like the BBC began reporting that the National Health Service had been hit with a major cyber attack, hospital staff and doctors' offices tried to stop the bleeding by unplugging computers that hadn't yet been infected. But the ransomware attack was spreading at lightning speed. It had already traversed from Southeast Asia to Russia, where it hit the Ministry of the Interior, across the Atlantic into North America, where it affected businesses like FedEx, and into mainland Europe, where it grabbed the Spanish telecom Telefonica and France's Renault. And now it was tearing across the United Kingdom and the island of Ireland. Estimates say a third of all hospital trusts in the United Kingdom were affected in those hours, along with 600 other doctors' offices. At least 19,000 appointments were canceled, though officials stopped counting. While major surgical operations were canceled, ambulances diverted to unaffected hospitals, and overloaded phone lines meant some chemo patients weren't able to reach emergency lines. A few hospitals, mistakenly believing the coast was clear, flipped machines back on, only to find them immediately caught in the ransomware. In all, over 230,000 computers in more than 150 countries succumbed to the spread. Each new device got the same message with the same running timer ticking down. The software came to be known as WannaCry. And unbeknownst to anyone that day, a clue about the perpetrator's identity was lurking in WannaCry's software. A bit of code copied from an attack done by the cybercrime group Lazarus. Now, this clue wouldn't be conclusive, but there's one important detail to know about Lazarus. They're widely believed to work on behalf of North Korea. The crimes of North Korea go back decades. And when I tell you crimes, I don't mean it in a North Korea bad, America good way. I mean North Korea's literal involvement in international crime like drug smuggling, counterfeiting, and insurance fraud. In 1974, under the leadership of Kim Jong-un's grandfather, Kim Il-sung, the North Korean government was strapped for cash for its military programs and the lavish lifestyle of the leadership. So it opened the doors on a shiny new government bureaucracy, Room 39. Named for the original office number, Room 39 became a large operation under Kim Jong-il. Its task was the acquisition of hard currency through international activity. Some of these activities included the legal export of exotic mushrooms, ginseng, and seaweed, but also insurance fraud on claims of industrial accidents, natural disasters, and inexplicable helicopter crashes. The department also directed the production and distribution of heroin, opium, meth, counterfeit cigarettes, weapons, and Viagra. Their most iconic scheme involved the production of fake $100 bills. And it's suspected that Room 39 continues to launder money through a chain of 150 North Korean-themed restaurants across Southeast Asia, where guests are served by women in traditional dress while enjoying dog meat soup and photos on the wall of former President Clinton with Kim Jong-il. It's all part of a larger so-called revolutionary fund and court economy that's carried on into the present day, utilizing front companies and tens of thousands of North Koreans domestically and worldwide, raising slush funds for the dear leader and top party officials to the tune of an estimated $500 million to $2 billion per year. But it's important to caveat that most sourcing on the illegal international operations of the North Korean regime date back between 2009 and 2011, during Kim Jong-il's reign and before Kim Jong-un succeeded him in the dynastic line. Which leads us back to the ransoming of computers in 2017. Is it possible that upon seizing control after his father's death, Kim Jong-un directed these arms of his government to focus their efforts on cybercrime, to achieve political ends and acquire hard currency through the use of hacking? We have a couple examples. You might remember the 2014 hack of Sony Pictures around the release of The Interview, during which the Lazarus Group tried to undermine a satirical film about Kim Jong-un by leaking a copy of the movie along with the personal data of Sony employees. You might have also heard about their 2016 botched attempt to steal $1 billion from the Federal Reserve in New York. Both these operations led many to believe Kim Jong-un was steering his outside operations towards cybercrime. And so when the copied code from a previous Lazarus attack appeared in the WannaCry ransomware in 2017, many suspected North Korea might have been behind the attack that crippled computers at hospitals and private companies worldwide. Suspicions were backed up with some evidence when cyber firms as well as the US and UK governments accused North Korea with a very high level of confidence. Here's how they, and public reporting, say it happened. In August of 2017, former National Security Agency contractor Harold Martin was arrested at his home in Maryland, accused of literally carrying out 50 terabytes of classified NSA data in hard copies and on thumb drives to be kept at his home, in his car, and in his backyard shed. Authorities suspected, though the evidence has never bore out, that Mr. Martin had to do with a threat from an organization called the Shadow Brokers. A year earlier, the mysterious organization advertised online that they were selling, for $580 million, stolen cyber weapons from the NSA. Among them, an exploit of Windows called Eternal Blue, which moves across local area networks and the internet. Devastating because it could infect computers on its own without a user accidentally downloading from a spammy website or clicking a shady link. But when they failed to sell the stolen wares, the shadow brokers dumped all their files onto the internet for anyone to download for free. A month before the global ransomware attack, bad actors worldwide had access. Now, Microsoft had already taken on the task of patching Windows 7, 8, and 10 after being tipped off about the leak of Eternal Blue. However, Windows XP, a version still in use by the UK's National Health Service, was no longer supported with security patches from Microsoft. So XP computers and any pre-Windows 10 PCs without the patch were vulnerable on the day of the attack, May 12th, 2017. The first breakout was in Asia at 7:45 a.m. GMT. The virus proceeded within 30 minutes over LAN connections and the internet to Latin America. Then within 2 hours to mainland Europe, then to North America. The ransomware was moving at lightning speed as designed. But of course, its most consequential impact would be in the UK's National Health Service. As money began to pour into the designated Bitcoin wallet, surgeries and appointments canceled, ambulances redirected, the system braced itself for disruption lasting well into the weekend and beyond. Until, and this is true, a man registered a domain. Marcus Hutchins, a 22-year-old working for Kryptos Logic, was examining the ransomware code that afternoon when he noticed it was linked to an unregistered domain. When he registered the domain, the virus stopped spreading. That simple. Now, if an unregistered domain sounds a bit amateur hour for a government-backed hacking organization, it's a good moment to bring up that some have speculated the attack was accidental or premature. Others have suggested it was a false flag by another group to frame the North Koreans. But even if the public and private sector consensus says that all signs point to North Korea, it's not that hard to see how this particular kind of doubt rings true. After global panic and 250,000 disabled machines, it all seems kind of pathetic and anticlimactic. A man in his bedroom at home stopped a group that hacked Sony and almost swindled $1 billion from the Federal Reserve. All they nabbed that weekend was about $50,000, and every now and again someone drops another 8 cents, another 47 cents into the Bitcoin wallet. Doesn't this all seem a bit below a government? This ignores one final detail: criminal sovereignty. It's the name of a report from the Strategic Studies Institute, and a concept tossed around by several journalists. Criminal sovereignty describes the specific way the North Korean government involves itself in crime. Think of a typical corrupt government somewhere in the world. The government is either incapable of stopping a criminal enterprise, or they're paid off to turn a blind eye. Think how former Mexican President Peña Nieto took $100 million from the drug lord El Chapo. In the worst cases, government officials and criminal enterprises are intertwined. For example, it recently came out that Brazil's President Bolsonaro, after running a campaign of anti-corruption, has a son linked to the death squad named the Crime Bureau. This corruption exemplifies crime infiltrating governments. But at their essence, they're two separate things: government and criminal enterprise. But with North Korea, the government and criminal enterprise are one and the same. The government bureaucracy is designed to violate international law as a matter of course. When the North Koreans traffic drugs, counterfeit money, hack computers, smuggle weapons, they aren't corrupting legitimate government functions. Those are the functions. It uses its flag, its diplomatic immunities, its sovereignty to carry out the business of keeping the regime afloat. The crime is the institution. So what connects a chain of money laundering restaurants and indiscriminate ransomware attacks, besides that they're bizarre and petty, is that neither are below the heavily isolated and internationally sanctioned government of North Korea. They are part of a quilt of illegal activity used to keep the Kims comfortable and the nuclear program progressing. Kim Jong-un presents a smilier face than his father to his nation, to South Korea, and to the wider world. But just as the execution of his uncle shows the domestic brutality remains in his early regime, so too do various hacks since his ascension demonstrate that while the tactics change, the international criminality remains the same. Here's a transition. You know what else is rough about North Korea? Average people don't have Skillshare. Whether it's video editing, animation, design, photography, or starting a business, Skillshare has more than 25,000 classes just right for you and your goals. Premium membership grants you unlimited access to courses taught by experts, designed to empower you to learn critical skills and unlock new opportunities. Now, specifically, I want you to join me in Mike Vardy's class on using Todoist to increase productivity. Todoist is a digital task manager I've used for a few years now, and this course helped me to reverse engineer my productivity framework. Annually, Skillshare premium membership is super affordable. Less than $10 a month. So join the 7 million creators learning and thriving with Skillshare. The first 500 members of this community to use the promo link in the description will get their first 2 months free to try it out. So be one of the first 500 to click the link in the description and get the 2 month risk-free trial. Learn new skills. Do what you love. Create. Try Skillshare today.